All right, welcome to Ed Show number 80. Good times. We had the launch week last week.
It's been an exciting week.
Wow. A pretty big deal there on the 18th. If you watched the news last week, I brought up the URLs because I shot it actually before they were available because it went live on Thursday. But now all those bits are definitely up there and available. And
so,
ready for you.
Well, I mean, what is that? That includes Windows Server 2012 R2.
Yep.
System Center 2012 R2.
Yep.
Windows 8.1 client.
Yep.
And even then the remote server administration tools for client if you want to manage Windows Server 2012. So
yes.
A lot of new releases. And you're going to see kind of continued releases for all the associated products, like new management packs for Operations Manager, new integration packs for Orchestrator. So it's a lot of new stuff. It's this big wave now.
If you haven't already started learning, be prepared to be drinking from a fire hose because there's a lot of new stuff there, right?
That is. Yeah. And I mean, that kind of leads us into like one of the next announcements we have, which is a lot of new TechNet VLABs.
Yep.
So if you're unfamiliar with VLABs, they're basically full virtualized environments where you get a step-by-step guide, your own private set of VMs, and you can walk through these guided exercises. And with this launch last week, we released 16 new VLABs for Windows Server and 3 new VLABs for System Center. So you get to really get a hands-on experience without having to go and deploy these infrastructures yourself. So a great way to kind of start to understand the new products, see how they fit in, and really see how they show these different connected scenarios. It's more of rather than a siloed product, very much a connected approach now, showing these different capabilities.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, our bits are aligned together as they have been for a while, and we're starting to bring more and more things kind of all in that motion together and at one Microsoft, right? Having
the
these experiences
OS.
Come together. Now, it isn't only about server stuff because we are a devices and services company. What good would that be without a new device, right? We have here the Surface 2. Now, I know earlier we talked about announcing the kind of roughly what the Surface 2 is about. We now have the pricing. It's now available to purchase through the Microsoft stores that are out there. And you know, pretty cool stuff. I mean, you know, the Surface was $349, the Surface 2 $449. And you know, you have the other goodness there is 200 gigabytes of SkyDrive storage and unlimited Skype minutes.
Very cool.
That's a pretty cool perk there for folks who are interested in a device side of things, you know?
Yeah, no, I was actually in Denmark last week, and they actually had one of the Surface 2 devices for the keynote there, so I got to play around with it. Very cool. It even has different angles that you can, you know, hold the device, so really cool. I can't wait to get one myself.
Yeah, definitely check it out. Thinner, lighter, more RAM, all that goodness. So yeah, but now that I diverge from the devices, I'm guessing there's a little bit more for training,
launch,
right?
Of course there
That's
is.
Right.
And we released a lot of new content on the Microsoft Virtual Academy. And you're going to see actually over the next month about a dozen new courses coming out, both covering Windows Server and System Center. This week, we've released Infrastructure Provisioning with System Center. So that's primarily looking at Virtual Machine Manager deploying the fabric. And then we look at Infrastructure Monitoring using Operations Manager. So that's after you've put everything out there, monitoring these different clouds, hardware, services, virtual machines, and applications. So if you want a good overview of what's new, System Center 2012 R2, go to the Microsoft Virtual Academy.
Yep, so we got a couple courses if you check out on the screen there, just to highlight them for the R2 piece there. There we go. And next up, we have an ebook on Windows Azure for IT professionals. So if you're the kind of person who likes to read, get the PDF out and on your favorite PDF device reader and want to learn about Windows Azure, this is a great book to cover a lot of the common scenarios of Windows Azure use cases and get you more familiar with the underlying technologies that are there. So
let me ask you, now since you're our evangelist for IT pros for Azure, why do we focus on what's different for IT pros when we look at Azure?
Yeah, well, so I think, you know, one thing for Windows Azure, it's a lot of people still have this notion of like, well, Windows Azure is just for developers.
It's a platform, right?
That's right. And you know, originally it kind of was. You know, there was, you know, when we first released Windows Azure a number of years ago, we had just a platform as a service offering, which is generally speaking more tailored for developers unless you're in the DevOps side of things, right?
Mm-hmm.
But we've had for quite some time now the infrastructure services or IaaS, you know, virtual machines up in Windows Azure where you can, you know, sign up for a free trial and in like 3 minutes have a Windows Server 2012 R2 machine up and running to play with, right?
Very cool.
So so it is very applicable for IT pros. It's kind of the way that things are headed, you
this
know?
This new cloud administrator.
That's right. I mean, yeah. Virtualization, that's important in the whole cloud OS and connecting things, but there's no way that you can operate with the efficiency of our data centers when we're pouring billions of dollars in. You know, it's kind of hard no matter how efficient your virtualization stack is in your company. You know, probably not going to quite beat that that efficiency that we have. So anyway, check out this interview right now. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to the show. In this episode, I'm joined by Michael, and we're going to be speaking about Linux integration. Now, if you've been watching the show recently, you've seen that we're talking more and more about these heterogeneous environments, being able to monitor and manage VMware, Citrix, Java, and now really focusing on Linux. So, Michael, what team do you work for, and what's your background in Linux here?
So I'm part of the Open Source Technology Center.
Okay.
That's a mouthful. We're part of the Windows Server and System Center division, and so we focus on running and managing Linux.
So do you now have, does this mean Microsoft now has a dedicated team that just works on Linux?
That's correct, as part of Windows Server and System Center, in the data center, in the private cloud, and in the public cloud.
I think that's a really interesting, you know, strategic move by Microsoft saying, hey, we know that most people are running Windows, we like Windows, but why did Microsoft say we want to continue investing in Linux? Like, why do we think that's important to us?
Well, we recognize that the world is heterogeneous. That's the reality of what's out there. Different computing devices, different operating systems, different languages platforms, .NET, Java, etc. And so, particularly in the server and data center space, we have focused on managing and running in that heterogeneous environment. That's what our customers have told us that they want us to do, and Microsoft has responded by offering products that play in that environment. So it's really a business decision. You know, the world is heterogeneous, we get it, mm-hmm. and that's the world that we want to play in.
And I think you're going to see a lot more investment in System Center specifically, right? Really trying to be this single product that does manage all these diverse environments, connect them, monitor them, deploy them, operate them. Yep. I guess we're going to kind of walk through some of those different operations.
We will indeed, yes.
Well, I guess first of all, what Linux distributions do we support?
Well, we focus on a lot of different Linux distributions. First thing, we focused on Linux servers. That's our key focus at this point from a marketing standpoint. And we have focused on the Linux distros that an enterprise would use to run real business applications,
okay.
whether that's in their data center or as part of a hoster, or in the public cloud. So we really have not gone after the desktop versions or the hobbyist versions of Linux. But so we've got a slide here that shows us kind of what the different distros are. You can see across in the Linux space, there are six different distros. Red Hat, SUSE, CentOS, Ubuntu, Debian, and Oracle there is, of course, Oracle Linux in the Linux category. And you can see the different components of System Center, different components of Hyper-V, and then of course Azure Virtual Machines as the public cloud. You can also see that we're supporting some of the Linux or the Unix operating systems, AIX, HPUX, and Solaris for Operations Manager and Config Manager, because again, that's part of that heterogeneous environment that we want to play in.
Nice, so we have really tried to focus across the board on these distributions.
That's
for the
correct.
Enterprise.
You know, and some of these have even been added fairly recently. You may have heard of the recent collaboration between Microsoft and Oracle.
Why don't you clarify that? We made a big announcement around the virtual machine support in Oracle. Yep.
And absolutely, that's what's given us the check marks here in the Oracle column for Virtual Machine Manager, for Hyper-V, and for Azure VMs. So.
Very nice.
We're really working to fill out this matrix and make sure that we've got a complete set of Linux distros that we support.
Well, now let's talk about virtualization, Hyper-V. Now, if you're going to run a virtual guest operating system within a VM, mm-hmm. one of the things we always try to do for the VM itself is make it what's called enlightened,
yes.
meaning it knows that it's running inside a VM.
Yes.
And so for that, we need to install what we call in Hyper-V world integration components.
Correct.
And you call that something differently. Could you kind of talk a little bit about how you guys have invested in that, how we make these Linux distributions work on Hyper-V?
Right. So as you pointed out, Hyper-V presents synthetic devices to the guest operating system in order to get good performance, particularly for disk I/O and for network I/O. And if you're going to have synthetic devices, and they're going to show up in the guest operating system, you need drivers for those synthetic devices.
Okay.
And so what Microsoft has done, we have developers who have written the Linux device drivers. that run in the Linux operating system to talk to those synthetic devices. And so we are, instead of emulating the real hardware, we're using those synthetic devices to really get good performance. And so that group of device drivers that we have written, we call the integration services. And to make them Linux specific, we call them the Linux Integration Services, or LIS.
LIS, okay. Yes. Great, so tell me a little more about like how people can get LIS. Does it come actually in the code itself? Can people add it on later?
In a lot of cases, it does come in the code. Our approach has been to work with the Linux community. And so we develop those drivers, we test them in-house here at Microsoft, and then we submit them to the Linux community. And the Linux community looks at them and they comment and they give feedback. We make adjustments, we make tweaks to make sure that they work really well within the Linux kernel environment. And then once those drivers have been approved, if you will, by the community, they go into the main Linux kernel. Once they're in the main Linux kernel, then we work with the Linux distro vendors to bring those drivers into individual Linux distributions. So we work with Red Hat around getting the drivers into Red Hat Enterprise Linux. We work with SUSE around getting them into the SUSE Linux Enterprise Server. We work with Canonical around getting them into Ubuntu. And so we maintain these relationships with the distro vendors then to get the drivers into the distro. So if you're working with a recent Linux distro, like SLES 11 SP2 or SP3, Linux Integration Services are already there. You install SLES 11 SP2, install that on Hyper-V, Linux Integration Services is there and just works.
Very nice.
If you're dealing with an older Linux distro where they may not already be present, there is a Microsoft downloadable package that you can get to install LIS into your older distro. So we offer it both ways. The model going forward, just have it built in so it's there as a normal part of the product.
Great. And I really just want to emphasize one point you said here. We have Microsoft developers writing the Linux code, checking in to the Linux kernel, doing peer reviews in the Linux community.
That's exactly what's happening.
That's really cool. I mean, that's, I guess, really evidence that Microsoft really is trying to invest in this, make it, you know, first-class citizen on top of our systems.
That's exactly what we're doing, yes.
Well, now let's move and talk a little more about data center management of Linux. So Virtual Machine Manager, what are kind of our integration points we have with Linux there?
Right. So VMM, of course, is Microsoft's product for managing the private cloud. And so one of the things we've done, so you manage Hyper-V hosts, you manage virtual networks, and you manage the guest VMs that you have deployed into that private cloud. And so one of the things we've done is we've made sure that Linux guest VMs are part of VMM, just like Windows guest VMs. And 98% of the user interface of what you interact with VMM really doesn't care whether it's Linux or whether it's Windows.
Consistent experience.
Experience. So you're just doing that, set up me a guest operating system and all of the storage management, the network management, all of that's the same across whether it's Windows or whether it's Linux. And so we've got a great story there. There's really only a little bit of UI that's different for the Linux case.
So you now actually have a demo that you could show us using Virtual Machine Manager showing how we can manage these Linux distributions, right?
Yes, I do. So you can see now the Virtual Machine Manager console. This, of course, is the console that the IT professional would use, either running the data center in the enterprise or running the data center at the hoster. You can see that we've got a couple of Hyper-V hosts here that we're managing. This particular Hyper-V host has six different Linux guest operating systems on it. It's also got a Windows guest operating system that's running on it. We've got another host that's got a Linux machine and a Windows machine running on it. So that's what's actually running on this private cloud that VMM is managing. If we go to the library area, we have this concept of virtual machine templates. This is a pre-configured and set up configuration of a virtual machine that you might deploy. And you can see we've got several different templates here. I'm going to pick one of these. This is SUSE Linux Enterprise Server, or SLES 11. And we're going to create a virtual machine from this template. This walks us through, we're going to call this the TechNet demo. Walks us through a little wizard here. We get a chance to configure the hardware, the virtual hardware that we want this virtual machine to run on. And I'm going to change the memory size from its default up to 1024 megabytes, give us a full gig. Then we get the screen where you actually do see some Linux-specific behaviors here. This is where you get a chance to specify the operating system configuration. And so you see we have SLES 11. This is going to be called labnx.pound pound. They'll fill in a number there. And here we specify the root credentials. That's, of course, a Linux concept.
Yeah, this is new. I haven't seen this before.
The root password. Yeah. Yep. And so we're going to pull the root password from a run as account that's been stored in Virtual Machine Manager, specify the time zone, and specify the run once commands. Now you see some Linux-specific command lines here. And so this particular template has been set up to bring in some things so it configures properly to be managed by System Center Operations Manager. But you've got full flexibility here to put arbitrary Linux command lines into the configuration that'll be run once that virtual machine is deployed. So we'll click Next here. We're going to select where Virtual Machine Manager will decide where to put this virtual machine. It's calculating, looking at the workloads that are on Hyper-V1 versus Hyper-V2. There we go. And it's rated Hyper-V2 as a little more preferable to Hyper-V1, so that's where it'll end up going. It's going to be called LabNX08. We'll click Next, take the rest of the options here. And we're off in the process now of actually creating a new virtual machine that'll be running SLES Linux in our private cloud. And in fact, if I close out of this and then go back to our VMs and services and take a look at Hyper-V2, you'll see we've got a line here now for TechNet demo. And it's in the creating process, about 59% done.
Very nice. So. Well, the next system center component I want to ask about is Windows Azure Pack. And Windows Azure Pack is new with System Center 2012, Windows Server 2012. And it basically allows you to run Azure-like services within your own data center. So if you kind of like that Azure end-user experience, easy to create VMs, having galleries, you can now do that, but within your own data center, so no dependency on Azure. Question to you now is, how do we manage our Linux distributions using the Windows Azure Pack?
Right, so here's a quick demo of the Windows Azure Pack. Windows Azure Pack, of course, is intended for more the end-user experience. This is not the IT pro. This is the business user who just needs to create a couple of VMs. Or if you're a hoster, this is the customer who's going to create a couple of VMs. You don't see Hyper-V here in this user interface. All you see is the virtual machines that you've created.
Yeah, we're kind of hiding all the hosts, the physical infrastructure.
Exactly. So I'm going to click on New here, and we're going to create a new standalone virtual machine from the gallery. And as you can see, we've got several different templates here. And in fact, these five templates are the same five templates that showed up in Virtual Machine Manager. And so we can pick one of these. We'll pick the Ubuntu 12 template in this case. And we're going to give this a name, MyVM. And we'll give this a password. And I have to type in a little bit of characters here because it won't let me do something short. Let's see here. Hopefully those match up. I'm going to skip the SSH key here just for going very quickly. We're going to attach this to a virtual network that's been pre-created by the guy who's running Virtual Machine Manager. And we'll call that Contoso. And we'll click the check mark there. And we're off creating a new virtual machine using the Windows Azure Pack. And if we go back to the virtual machines list here, then you can see that we're creating it, and it has now showed up in the list, and we're creating that virtual machine. And what's really interesting is, suppose you're the actual IT guy. Mm-hmm. So let's go back to Virtual Machine Manager. And if we go back and take a look at what's happening here, we'll now see that MyVM that was created in Windows Azure Pack now shows up and is visible to the IT professional who's actually managing that private cloud.
Very nice, and seeing how quickly they're connected.
So they're very well connected there, yes.
Great. So next question is, you know, we've gone and deployed this infrastructure. Now we want to go and monitor these VMs, make sure they're healthy. What does Operations Manager do with Linux?
Great. So we have great integration in Operations Manager with Linux. So you can monitor your Linux servers right alongside your Windows servers in the same view. And so we've got just the top level view here. So we've got some Windows computers that we're managing here in Ops Manager. A couple of the Hyper-V hosts are showing up here. And we've got some Unix and some Linux computers that we are managing in Ops Manager. Got a couple of them that are even marked critical here. Turns out in this demo environment, the disk can sometimes get kind of slow. And we've got a critical alert here on the physical disk for this particular Linux machine. Let's take a look if we go to a particular Linux machine and we open up the Health Explorer. We can see all the different things that we are actually monitoring for this Linux computer. So you can see, for example, in the operating system, we are monitoring all of the different Linux daemon processes. So we're monitoring the cron daemon and the klog and the SSH daemon. So if those daemons were to go down, we'll get an alert in Ops Manager that, hey, you've got a problem with your Linux machine that you need to go monitor. And just for good measure, why don't we actually just go do that? I'm actually logged into this Linux machine right here. And if we look for the cron daemon, we'll see that it's PID number 7567. I'm going to kill that guy off. That's going to terminate that process. And if we do the PS again, we'll see that there is no cron daemon running anymore. I've got this set up to monitor on about a 30-second interval. So we'll go back and take a look in just a second here and see if we've in fact generated an alert.
Now, while that's refreshing, let me ask you, what kind of requirements are there around installing agents? Do you need to actually install anything within the Linux guest virtual machine or on a Linux host to be able to monitor it?
Yes, we do. So we do have an agent that Microsoft has written that is part of System Center, part of System Center Operations Manager. We ship that agent, and there are various installation processes. You can have that automatic from Ops Manager. You can manually install that agent into your Linux systems.
And is that the same regular agent that Operations Manager uses, or is that different?
It is different. For Linux? It is different for Linux than it is for Windows. So different code base, different set of things that it's trying to solve. You can see here. Here's a quick graph of some operating system performance metrics that we see for one of the Linux machines. We have information about overall health and performance, the disk state. We can see all the disks that are healthy, their size in bytes. So quite a bit of information that we're monitoring on those Linux machines to make sure if you're running out of disk space, you'll get an alert. If you're running out of inodes, you'll get an alert. Really, all of the same things that we're monitoring on a Windows computer, we're also monitoring on a Linux machine.
Nice.
So let's go back and take a look, see if we have any alerts at this point. Indeed, we do. There's an alert there. Oh, that was earlier. Let me go take a look at this particular Linux computer and see whether we've got the view now. And you can see here, we have a red X now that the cron service, the cron daemon's not running. Surprise, we killed it off. Ops Manager has detected that, and we are now in a red state indicating that we have a problem. And in fact, we can interestingly go down here and take a look at what was going on. We get more details about the processes that were running on Linux. And down here at the very bottom, we actually have a recovery process where we can say, hey, looks like cron daemon's not running. Let's restart that cron daemon. And so here from the Ops Manager console, we're going to reach out to that Linux box and automatically restart the cron daemon.
Very nice.
And so again, if we give that a few seconds, we'll find that the critical state on that machine will go away and we'll be back green again.
Awesome. Wow, that's really deep, very insightful there. Now, we've got our deployment up, we've got our monitoring. What about configuring it? So how could Configuration Manager integrate with Linux?
Indeed we do. We have integration with Configuration Manager, and let's take a look at that console as well. So here's the Configuration Manager console, Config Manager 2012 R2. Interface people have gotten to know since Config Manager 2012. We're in the Assets and Compliance section. That's the What Am I Managing section of Config Manager. And we're looking at the devices portion here. And so you see a lot of different computers listed. And you know, we have a SLES computer and a Debian machine. We have an HPUX on the Unix side of the world that we're managing. And so all of the different computers are showing up here. And indeed, we do have some Linux machines and some Unix machines in this list. One of the interesting things to do is to go take a look at one of these Linux machines, and you'll see that the Java is not installed here. I try to run Java, and I get, hey, the program's not there. And so it turns out that I actually, in my software library for Config Manager, I have a package which is Java for SLES Linux.
Okay.
And we can very easily right-click here, and I'm going to do a deployment. I'm actually going to deploy new software, which is that Java package, to a collection, which is all of my SLES 11 computers. So maybe I got a new version of the Java runtime, any kind of software that I need to deploy out to a set of Linux machines. And this, is something that has been done on the Windows side for a long time. Config Manager deploys software to Windows machines. And so if we click through the wizard here fairly quickly, we're going to do this right now, assign immediately. We'll click Next, choose all the default options here, and we are off doing a software deployment to a Linux computer. Now, while we're waiting for that to happen, I want to take one quick look here. We'll go back to our assets and compliance. And if we take a look at this SLES machine, we can see inventory information about this. This is another thing Config Manager does, is it collects hardware inventory information about the computer. And so we can find out all kinds of interesting information, just like on the Windows side, about our Linux machines that we are managing as part of our data center or as part of our private cloud. So let me go, I'm going to go back to the Linux machine here. I need to hit this machine and tell it to wake up in order to do the, there we go, that's the command line I need. Config Manager, the client wakes up periodically and figures out what does it need to do. And for demo purposes, you sort of need to kick it and say, hey, go do it right now. Yeah. So the demo will run quickly. We'll take a quick look too and look at the processes that are running out here. And again, we have an agent. So you see /op/Microsoft. There's an OMI server process. There's a CCM exec process. That's the agent that's actually doing the work for us, just like with Ops Manager, in order to monitor the computer. Config Manager has an agent in order to do that. So let's take a quick look here. Let's see if we've gotten Java installed. Voila, the Java command line now gives us its help information, whereas it was failing before. Config Manager has successfully installed Java onto this machine.
Very nice. Well, we are not done with the System Center line of products. So tell me, Data Protection Manager,
yes.
Does that work with Linux?
It does work with Linux. New in the 2012 R2 release, Data Protection Manager can back up Linux virtual machines that are running on Hyper-V. Prior to R2, you would have had to pause or stop that Linux virtual machine, which is not really what you want to do in a production environment.
Is that to ensure memory consistency?
Yes, it was to ensure consistency. And so what we've done in the new R2 release is we now have the ability to flush the file system buffers of that Linux VM and then take that snapshot and do that backup. And that all happens automatically and transparently so that you get the same kind of backup behavior with Linux VMs that you've been getting with Windows VMs.
Very nice. And last but not least, automation. You know,
yes.
A lot of people are now really getting excited about Orchestrator, being able to tie these separate systems together. How can we go and tie our Linux systems with Orchestrator?
So certainly doing IT process automation with Orchestrator, you may want to do Linux machines. In a Orchestrator run book, there's an activity called run SSH command line.
Mm-hmm.
And that will connect via SSH to a Linux machine, to a Unix machine, using standard protocols. And then you can send any command line you want down to that Linux machine.
Both so physical and virtual as well,
both physical
right?
and virtual. And so if you've got an IT process where you need to go do something to a Linux or a Unix machine, you've now got that capability with Orchestrator.
Wow. So I guess, you know, hopefully people could see Microsoft is really, really invested in Linux. But are there customers out there using this today?
Yeah, people were really surprised when they learned that Microsoft's doing all this Linux work. And in fact, we've been doing it for about 5 years now.
Nice.
And our data shows that there are literally thousands of System Center customers out there today who are managing Linux and Unix with System Center. And in aggregate, hundreds of thousands of Linux and Unix servers are being managed in a production environment today.
Real world production stuff.
And so, you know, that really does validate our goal, which was let's play in this heterogeneous environment. And again, customers are surprised, but the world is heterogeneous. We get it.
Great. Well, thanks so much for coming on the show. There's a lot of information you gave us here, though. Where could people go to learn more?
So there's certainly information on TechNet about all of our Linux and Unix capabilities.
Okay.
There are recordings on Channel 9 of sessions that we've done at TechEd, for example. So a lot of great information that's out there available to you.
Great. Well, Michael, thanks so much for joining me on the show. Hopefully our viewers out here learned a lot more about this. I know I learned a lot. So thanks again for coming on the show. Great
stuff. Thank you very much. Glad I could do it.
Thanks.
So definitely if you've got questions on this interview specifically, feel free to comment below. And if you want to get a hold of us at Edge, there's lots of ways to do that, edge@microsoft.com. Email us. You can tweet us at TNEdge or join our Facebook page. Check us out.
Don't forget the app as well.
Oh, the app, yes. Don't forget about the app. We got to keep mentioning the app. It's goodness. Download it offline, viewers, right? Play us at different speeds.
And send your feedback through that as well.
That's right. That's right. Most definitely.
Thanks a lot.